Hello, everyone. How you doing? Oh, that's exciting. So welcome to the keynote panel here at the 17th Annual Pop Conference. My name, as Jason just mentioned, is Jason King, not two Jasons. And I'm the producer of tonight's keynote, which is Going Up Yonder, How Music Makers and Writers Confront Loss and Grief. First, let me just get some business out of the way, but important business. I want to thank some sponsors who helped make tonight possible. Billboard, I want to thank Denise, I want to thank Rob Levine, the entire staff there. I also want to thank the Clive Davis Institute of Recorded Music, which is the institute that I work at New York University, as you can applaud. Thank them for stepping in and making this possible, especially thank you to Jeff Rabhan for his continued support of this conference. Thanks to Brian Hayes and Ayanna Wilson. At Mopop, I want to thank Jason Porter, Robert Rutherford, Anthony Angelora, Brian Epps, Silas Stokes, Lara Banker, Amanda, Michelle. Thanks to Eric Weisbard and to Ann Powers, who shepherded this conference for so many years and made it possible for us to be here tonight. To Jason Emmons as well for lighting the flame and keeping it going. Thanks to Charles Hughes. Also, it does take a village to make an evening like this possible and to get so many fantastic artists here. So I want to thank all of their reps and friends, Sapna Lal, Michael Bardier from Heavy Trip, Nakong Del Vecchio, Direct Management, Benny Tarantini from BTPR. There's a lot more people to thank, but I want to thank those folks especially. And though organizing a panel on tonight's topic was definitely a challenge, when I heard the topic, I said, wow, how am I going to put a panel together on this subject? But I think I made life easier for myself in a few ways. The first way I did that was to invite Ann Powers back to moderate. Ann has been fantastically moderating the keynotes since the conference began. I saw no reason to discontinue her keynote fabulosity. So she's here again. And I'll quickly give a little bit of bio on her, and then she'll come up in a second. Ann Powers is one of the nation's most notable music critics. She's currently NPR's music critic and correspondent. Prior to that, she was chief pop music critic at the Los Angeles Times, the New York Times, Blender, Village Voice. Her books include Tori Amos, Piece by Piece, with Tori, Weird Like Us, My Bohemian America, and co-editor with Evelyn McDonald of Rock, She Wrote. So you'll, and your newest book, Good Booty. How can I forget? Fantastic Good Booty. Sorry, it wasn't in your bio, but I'm happy to represent it for you right now. Thank you, Anne. Okay, so you're gonna hear from Anne in a moment. The second thing I did right and made easy for myself tonight was to invite the great Daphne Brooks to give us some framing comments. So Daphne, do you wanna start making your way up here? So full disclosure, the actual genesis of the idea for this panel came from Daphne. We were talking about ideas of things to do and she suggested a panel on grief writing. Thought it was a great idea, and it kind of built from there. So I want to thank her publicly for being such an important part of the visionary idea behind all of this. Yes. So she had to be on the panel, and as I said, she's going to give some framing remarks now. So let me just give a little bio. Daphne Brooks is the William Kenan Jr. Professor of African American Studies, Theater Studies, American Studies, and Woman and Gender and Sexuality Studies at Yale University. No? Yeah, just a little bit of it. We gotta give you something. She's the author of Bodies in Dissent, Spectacular Performances of Race and Freedom, and also Jeff Buckley's Grace from the 33 and a Third series. She's working on a number of different projects, including Black Star Rising and The Purple Rain, celebrating the legacies of David Bowie and Prince. So without further ado, here is Daphne Brooks.
All right. Thank you, Jason King. I realize at the outset of my remarks, and I am making remarks, I was given the charge of kind of setting things up, giving a sense of where we might go, not just this evening, but this weekend, that in doing this, I'm the only thing standing in between you and our fabulous distinguished guests. So bear with me, God help us. I want to thank Jason King, I want to thank Charles Hughes and this year's conference committee. I'm always happy to be here at our home, away from home. This is the 18th, is it the 18th PopCon? And like many familiar faces here tonight, I've been here for every single one of them. I started when I was a toddler. It is for me, and for so many of us, a site of refuge and experimentation, a place where collaborations flourish, where we butt heads and likewise break bread, a place where the richness of our cultural and sociopolitical passions about sound can thrive and take unexpected turns. And I thought a lot about the specialness of this place last October when Microsoft co-founder, the brainchild of the museum, we were just discussing him, Paul Allen passed away from cancer-related causes. I know the highlights of Mr. Allen's achievements, which we just saw, but a little about the details about his path-breaking career in the tech world, as well as his dedication to philanthropic causes, of which there were many. But as we begin yet another year of sharing our work with one another, it's worth pausing for a moment to recognize that would it not for Paul Allen, who built a house that Eric Weisbord and Ann Powers could preside over for many, many years, would it not for him, some of us may never have had the chance to write new books and articles, pick up gigs at new publications, recruit new faculty, start blogs and organize symposia and launch writing groups and book series. Some of us may have never discovered unique voices as music writers. Some of us may have never had the opportunity to give birth to altogether different and wholly distinct voices in print and public. And so for all of these reasons, a moment of silence is still in order for the Hendrix-loving, guitar-playing, sci-fi super nerd Paul Allen. He will be missed. And now a round of applause for him. Okay. Yeah. All right, folks. So, dearly beloved, we are gathered here this weekend to get through this thing called life and to think out loud beside one another about the ways in which catastrophic loss is managed by the ones left behind, specifically the music makers who've experienced both private as well as very public forms of grief and bereavement, the fellow musicians, of course, and the fans, the small and intimate, the proudly local, as well as the global communities who are radically affected by the departures of artists whose work was of great, lasting, and vital value to others. We've come together this weekend to think together about the forms of art born out of mourning the ones who left their sonic imprint on our spirit. The forms of art, whole genres of music tenaciously driven by the dual investment in marking loss and yet stubbornly rejecting annihilation. We are with one another this weekend to, for instance, recognize and revel in the art of the extended black vernacular homegoing, an exercise in extreme temporal endurance that seeks to both expel sorrow and to simultaneously revel in it so as to wrestle it to the floor and arise new again, forever reconnected in potently lasting ways to the fallen. We're here in the middle of April 2019 to listen closely to the insurgent voices of the marginalized, those from the past and those in the streets right now who will not go quietly into the night, the ones who use sound as a weapon to overturn the structures that seek to muzzle them. We are here in these familiar halls once more to explore the ways that we, lovers of music, forge rituals designed to commune with the spirits, as well as the ways that some of said rituals, holograms, may be ill-advised, I don't know. We are interested in the genre of the musical biopic, a prime example of the art of surrogation, if ever there was one, reminding us of how surrogation, that process coined by legendary performance studies scholar Joe Roach, encapsulates the ways that actors step into the cavities of loss and fill them imperfectly for a community in mourning. Surrogation in the biopic form, when it's done exceptionally well, allows for audiences to have a conversation with the actor about the precious thing mourned, the ineffable thing, the virtuosity, as well as the charisma, Pace, Sonnet, Rettman, and Erica Edwards, of the performer who is no longer. When it fails, it's equally fascinating, but excruciating to some, nonetheless. So we would do well to perhaps consider tributes to the departed that work to galvanize our senses in some indelible way and ask why this is so. Just as well, we might turn to the ones that don't work, maybe to some, and ask what went wrong. not to be forgotten, as well, are the aesthetic endeavors that seek to address large-scale calamity and catastrophe, or public tragedies situated in the run of popular music phenomena. The polarizing 2018 Natalie Portman indie Vox Lux is, for instance, a flawed yet nonetheless provocative meditation on turn-of-the-century Max Martin-era pop's contiguous rise alongside the proliferation of school shootings and the simultaneous emergence of new media technologies. Is there grief that undergirds those early Britney earworms, this film seems to ask? Are those buoyant b-boy leaps in the air a defiant anodyne to beat back the melancholic ubiquity of mass violence as media event? If so, it wouldn't be the first time that music has served as this sort of a salve in the modern era. So we are interested in sitting, no doubt uncomfortably, with our own palpable sadness that erupts out of the recognition that figures with whom we forged intimate ties through their art will no longer make work that opens up our consciousness, drives our pleasures, our angst, and our ire, provides us with catharsis, fires up and fuels our senses, makes us feel more alive. So inevitably this weekend, we will no doubt have to address the ways in which our own mortality is entangled with the artists who've passed on, out of this world. We will have to recognize the obvious, that our grief, that over which we weep, has everything to do with the heightened mindfulness of our own time, time that we've spent with the music that changed us, that comforted us, that affirmed our own being in some deep bone way, the music that constituted the fabric of our lives. We know that particularly when the ones who were with us for long durées, for multiple epochs, through many dangers, as James Cleveland puts it in relation to Aretha's Amazing Grace performance, when these wondrous figures have passed on, we are confronted with a panoramic onslaught of memories constitutive of our own time on Earth, the dance steps you were learning with your teen big sister as the J5 held center stage on Soul Train. No rocket science here. But music grief has its own distinct register, and we might think about that tonight and all weekend long. We might think about the strange particularities of this form of bereavement, the details of how we mourn our past or present intimacies with records and artists whose meaning heightens and intensifies in moments of unspeakable disaster. I wanted to be here this year, just like I do every year, but especially this year, though, to be in conversation with my brethren about the craft that takes shape, is driven by, makes unexpected turns, serves as a respite for, and rises to meet, grapple with, and translate the tumultuous wave of emotions sparked by the loss of our beloved, the ones we can't imagine living without. I'll leave it up to our genius artists, who'll be joining us up on the stage in just a moment, to share what this means to them in the music-making process, and my hero, Ann Powers, will be guiding us through our discussion tonight. But as we turn into our conversation, I wanted to thank my fellow writers and scholars and thinkers, another hero here with me tonight, David Toop, and all of you who've traveled from nearby and afar. I want to thank you all in advance for examining the delicacy of your own vulnerability that perhaps informs your own work, your own writing about music this weekend and beyond. So two final and very brief personal examples I'll quickly offer as a way to transition into our main event. And they are examples directly linked to the time I've spent in this wacky Frank Gehry structure. The 2005 33 and one-third volume that I wrote about the late Jeff Buckley's soul studio album Grace was a project whose seeds were planted at the conference, but which I initially refused to do precisely because it was clear to me that it would necessitate my own hopefully clear-eyed confrontation with the loss of this musician who built my world in my angsty, heart-shaped box, grunge-soaked mid-20s graduate school years. And it would require writing with honesty and authenticity, as well as carefully addressing my own presence, my own relationality to the music and the story that I was telling. It would take finding a way to hold myself up as an object of inquiry alongside the music in question, as a way to honor its power over me without obscuring the music itself, without, in short, turning the study of Buckley's epic album into a solipsistic exercise. It would also demand that I take seriously and grapple with the other layers of grief coursing through my life that stretched from Buckley's drowning on the day I finished my dissertation and the long illness of my father who passed away the summer that I began working on the Grace book and which changed my relationship to his raw, bleeding heart rock balladry yet again. The number of fellow writers who do this very well is too long to list here. Most of them are on the premises for this conference. But I say this only to encourage us to share what it takes to do this kind of thing ethically and imaginatively. So this weekend we might ask, what are the inventive ways that we look after, as my colleague Kara Keeling puts it, that which has been left behind? What kind of writing evokes the beauty of close companionship with the music that matters to us, that which elicits dreaming and longing and transformation, boundless joy, as well as haunting darkness and restlessness in our souls? The very best example of an assignment that called upon some of us to do just this was the 2004 inaugural critical karaoke session invented by Joshua Clover here at the then EMP Museum, and which has subsequently taken on many lives and revolutionized how many of us approach writing music altogether, music writing altogether. Take one song and write about its meaning to you, its elements that stand out to you like an insistent punctum, its layers of resonance at the level of personal as well as public consciousness. Write about and alongside that song, but your remarks can be no longer than the song itself. As some of you know from that session, all those years ago now, the song that I chose was Lights. Lights. Maybe we can have just a little bit of music, maybe? Am I in charge of that? No, I don't think I am. Can we get... Well, come on, really? Okay. I chose Lights. That was my song selection. And for me, that writing stands as the... Yeah, they'll fill it in, right? Stands as the most important eulogy I delivered for my... I'm good with you singing along. I delivered for my late father as my memories of growing up in the 1970s and 80s San Francisco Bay Area came to light. The strangeness, the sui generis, marvelous weirdness, and sometimes disturbing unpredictability of that time and place could be summed up for me in the narrative around my memories of listening to that song as a child. What that assignment drew out of me and my fellow presenters, Josh, Ann, Grail Marcus, Oliver Wang, John Caramonica, I think was there, somebody else told me, among others. What I think it drew out of me was a heightened commitment to writing economically. You've got 3 minutes to get everything across the transom, and yet vividly, write with precision, and what I can only describe for myself as a kind of analytic chromaticism, so calling upon critical notes outside of a conventional reading of the music in question, playing everything all at once in prose in order to evoke something larger, wider, and deeper through and beyond the music itself. Write it, if you can, all at once through the lenses of the personal, the visceral, the cerebral, the emotional, the political, the historical, the social, the sonic. Write the attendance to the form as well as the content of the sound that rocks you to your core. Write with immediacy and surprising affective turns to jolt your reader's sensibilities. See, for instance, memorial works showcasing the humor of Wesley Morris, the steady urgency of Grail Marcus, the dense wit of Greg Tate, the expansive vistas of a career laid out by Jason King, the brave introspection of Carl Wilson, the poignant details of a musician's technique offered by Bob Criscow, the eloquent summation of an artist's lasting meaningfulness by Ann Powers, and on, we know that this list is shamefully incomplete and could be comprised of any number of you out there. I wanted to be here this weekend to talk with my fellow travelers, the fam, about that which we know is true, that music writing is inherently always concerned with and comprised of loss, absence, imperfection, the pursuit of approximating what can never be translated directly into prose, what cultural critic Brent Edwards famously refers to as the elusive edge between the oral and written in Black modern expressive cultures. It is the situation that elicits the famous question that Edwards poses: what does it mean to approach music? What form does music take in a poetics of transcription? Or perhaps even more specific to the work that we do here, what form does the condition of our listening to music make as we translate it into prose and reckon with our mournfulness? Critics from Peter Zendi to Alexandra Vasquez have shown us the way in this regard. Karen Tongson, too. I wanted to flag the importance of what we do in these moments of crisis because it's my humble belief that we have a mighty opportunity and responsibility to extend the condition conjured for us by the artist whom we so adored, to in short, heighten the awareness of our connection to one another, to celebrate what Judith Butler might call the ethics of sonic cohabitation. This vision is what guided our gathering on the passages of David Bowie and Prince at Yale in 2017, and it is a vision that has framed every single one of our meetings here in the springtime Pacific Northwest. We assemble in order to make sense of the music that calls upon our sense of being beholden to something greater than ourselves.
no words will suffice. But the striving for language is a risk to take that in and of itself has the ability to connect us to one another as we huddle together and stare out into the universe. And with that, I'm going to hand the mic over to Ann Powers.
Let me, Ann, come up here, but I just want to say thank you, Daphne Brooks. And I just want to bring up the entire panel so we can just kick it off. So Ann Powers, Daphne Brooks, let's welcome Ishmael Butler, Efrim Manuck, Steve Perry, and David Toop.
My mic on. Is this thing on? Is this thing on? I feel like that. I do that every year. It's my my greeting. Is this thing on? Well, this thing is on. Thank you all for being here, Daphne. That was beautiful. And I wish we could have heard Lights, a song that I also have strong feelings about, as far as...
Do you see the sideburns on that guy? That's what I want to know.
This is the most eclectic pop conference panel ever assembled. So, Jason King, I got to give it to you. The cosmopolitan wonder that you are. You brought together a fascinating group. I want to say, if you have a seat next to you, can you raise your hand? And there's some people standing. Come sit. Let's take the 20 seconds, and some people come claim some seats here, because there are some seats. We don't want you to have to stand. Okay. So I'm going to try to wing these bios, because you all have Wikipedia. You can look up the massive accomplishments of the people up here with me. So you've met Daphne. To my immediate left is Ishmael Butler, one of the most innovative and fascinating forces in hip-hop, with Digable Planets, with Cherry Wine, and most recently with Shabazz Palaces, a group that really changed the course of hip-hop in a lot of ways, and is still doing brilliant work. Also has a new group called Knife Nights. The most recent albums by Digable Planets, I just want to give a quick plug to, because they're incredible. And they're called Quasars, Born on a Gangster Star, and Quasars versus the Jealous Machines. And they take you on a deep journey through time and space. They are truly epic, funkadelic, rich, sonic wonders. So check those albums. To my right, David Toop. One of truly the most important music writers who's ever lived. We can't believe he's only at the conference first year this year. Has been making music since the early 70s and has been writing about music since the 80s. And his incredible books include the first really crucial book on hip-hop, Rap Attack, the definitive book on ambient music, Ocean of Sound. I could list many more. Exotica, which was a fascinating trip into exactly what the title says. One of my favorites, Haunted Weather, Music, Silence, and Memory. And I could go on, but most recently he has a new book, autobiography, called Flutter Echo, that is an autobiography of listening, and it's truly astounding. And it's coming out, when is it coming out in English? In May. So please check out that book, Flutter Echo. And then we have Efrim Manuck, who I have sat at the feet of when I've seen one of my favorite groups, Godspeed You, Black Emperor, a group that bends time and space also in a different way. He also has a band called the Silver Mount Zion Band, that Memorial Orchestra, right? That we're going to be talking about a little bit. And it's not really a band. It's more like a revolving ensemble and soul project. And he makes wonderful records under his own name as well. And I encourage you to check them out, especially my favorite, which is called Play Is High Gospel. We're going to talk a little bit about that project. But and then to my far right, we have Steve Perry. The Voice, what can I say? Front man for Journey, really one of the most iconic voices in rock and roll. And also, Steve has released several solo albums, 84 is Street Talk, 94 is For the Love of Strange Medicine, and most recently, Traces from 2018. which is why he's here today in many ways, and we're going to be talking about that record. So, that's our panel. So I want to start by just saying something about grief. Thinking about grief, it's one of the most personal and idiosyncratic experiences, and also one of the most universal, ritualized, and in some senses abstract. Everyone feels and lives through grief differently, and in some ways alone, and yet we have created so much culturally from it, arguably all religion, for example. Music and art are a means to bridge the gap between that completely incomprehensible, inexpressible individual experience of loss, of grief, of haunting, and our culture's sanctions ways of dealing with it. And I want to read just two quotes from Flutter Echo, David's new book, that I think can kind of ground this conversation. The first, and both of these are you wrote, David, when you were talking about your own grief after your wife died in the 90s, but they are more general comments. First, he says, I talked at length with my anthropologist friend, Ragnar Johnson, who told me of Australian Aboriginal rituals, which sanctioned anger and aggression in bereavement. Spirits haunting the resting place of the dead were attacked with spears. Our own bereavement rituals are models of self-control, bounded by taboos, silences, and terrors disguised as respect, pursued by unspoken, sometimes spoken expectations that life should return to normal as soon as possible. So see in there is this vast difference in the way different cultures have approached grief. And I think in the Western world, it's arguable that popular music attacks grief with spears sometimes, with something we don't allow ourselves to do otherwise. Another quote says, stubborn, slow, and insistent, grieving's time span is totally opposed to the hype and discard pace that motors our lives. And Daphne and I were talking a little bit about this. I think music is another thing that changes time. Both grief and music challenge the way that we move through time. So those are just a few general thoughts that I had on this subject. So the first question I'd like to throw out to the group is, what does grief do to time? And how, as writers and musicians, do we try to reflect the experience of what grief does to time? And I guess I'll ask you first, David, because I feel you might have something to say.
Well, Ishmael and I were talking upstairs in the green room about Sun Ra. And Sun Ra had a tune called It's After the End of the World, Don't You Know That Yet? And I think, I mean, as you say, Anne, everybody has a different approach to grief. But for me, it was certainly a feeling that I'd suddenly collided in that way with reality. Musicians, anybody involved with music, whether they be musicians, composers, writers, is dealing at a more or less sophisticated level with time. But suddenly, when this kind of death hits you, you know, the kind of death which has a catastrophic impact in all directions, then suddenly you feel that, well, I certainly felt like I was in the world in much the same way that Sun Ra is saying, you know, until you realize that the world has ended, you don't know what's going on. So, I mean, there are many ways to think about time and the way it changes, but musicians, they deal with beginnings, endings, flow at different levels, but, you know, that sense of a sudden ending, it really does introduce you to a new sense of time.
Is there always a kind of loss in the moment that music is being made? Because sound, as you also say in your book, it dissolves like water on a rock. Do you think music contains loss inherently? I'm asking you.
I don't. I think that the act, the choices, the vibration is always a game, always a in movement is in action is life. And so I don't think so.
I like that positivity. I feel when I listen to something I love, I always think, I don't know, part of me becomes sad. I don't know, because I think of it in that live moment. But do you think the experience of music has changed, the loss in it changed in the recording era? I mean, does the fact of recorded music really preserve it? Or are recordings always haunted? What do you think? Are recordings haunted?
In what sense? I mean, yeah, recordings are always haunted because they're only speaking to, like, an element of the moment, you know? So the moment is always haunted, you know? And the moment is always subjective. It all falls into memory 3 seconds after you do it, you know? So, yeah, I mean, life is haunted, and life is filled with grief, you know? And there are profound griefs, and there are daily griefs, and, yeah. For sure, recordings are haunted.
Personally, I think that for me, I'm a pretty melancholy mofo kind of guy. I kind of live in a melancholy state all the time. For me, I guess, is that too much sadness? I don't know. It does keep me, it keeps me centered. It keeps me in the moment. Am I a depressive guy? I don't know. I think I call it melancholy. I write music that I think speaks from that place. And when I had my profound loss with Kelly a few years back, I agree that being pulled into the moment deeper than I ever experienced before was a new place, you know, a new place to where everything that mattered, I thought, fell off. And that I was telling you before we came out here that I seeked professional help to try to really learn how to grieve because I didn't know how. And so the professional I was going to turned to me. He said, I think you need to cherish the grief. And I said, excuse me? I'm tired of crying. I've been crying so much. It's been going on now for months. And he said, I know that, but if you cherish the grief that you're in right now, I guarantee you there will come a time where you won't be able to access it as deeply and as clearly and in the moment as you are now. So I think as it starts to come up and you start to get back to whatever happens once we do face the grief and cherish it, you'll be glad you did. And so that's just been my experience. Everybody wants to pull out of it. And as you said, get back to normal. Man, I wanted it just to move on. But now I'm so grateful that I didn't.
Steve, can you share the story? I know many people know it in this room, but of Making Traces and how it came about.
It's a complex record because there was 2 songs I wrote that were about profound grief. One called In the Rain, which is the darkness of grief, sitting, you know, pictures that stare back in silence by myself. The other one is a song called Most of All, which is a little bit more uplifting, but still about loss. But those songs were written before I had met Kelly, which was really bizarre. And they were so profoundly about loss that I was afraid to play them for her when she was struggling to win her battle against cancer, because I didn't want to put that energy into her struggle. So that's the only thing I kept from her, was those 2 songs I had written before I met her. So after she had passed away, I went back to my hard drive and found them and went, wow, these songs feel like they were about her before I met her.
Let's hear a little bit of In the Rain. You can do that by titles, right? My nice sound person.
I wish you were here tonight.
It's a little hard to turn down Steve Perry's voice, honestly. So So for those who don't know, Kelly Nash was your partner, and did she have cancer when you met her?
She had, when I met her, she had been fighting cancer for about 3 years, but you'd never know it. She looked amazing, and we just had this connection, something I never experienced before, and I just couldn't stay away from her. And so we were together for a year and a half, and we fought it together, and it was frightening because it was facing potentials, falling in love with potentials of loss on the front end. And it was something insane to me, but honestly, I had nowhere to go because that's all I want. I wanted to just be there, you know.
Yeah. And so you started writing that song before, and
I wrote that song way before I met her. No, I wrote that song way before I met her. And it was about profound loss, because I have loss in my life. We all have loss. That's what's so amazing. I know you're here to meet everybody, but I know you're here because you've had loss. Nobody in this room, if you're alive, doesn't have loss. And yet we don't want to talk about it or embrace it, you know? Really, and that's, to me, important. I mean, really important.
Absolutely. So David, in Flutter Echo, you write about the aftermath of your wife's death in 1995, Kimberly, and how it affected both your prose style and your music-making process. And you write about a track, and I just want to play it. It's quite different than the one we just heard. Can you play Ceremony, please?
Lead a gesture for them to stop. They picked up a broad, heavy wooden disc.
I hate to cut it. You need to listen to the whole thing, but that's an amazing piece of music. The whole title is Ceremony Viewed Through Iron Slit. Can you talk a little bit about I'm not going to even frame the question. Tell us a little bit about that composition.
Well, I think the thing to say is that my wife's death was a suicide. A very sudden one. And we had a daughter who was just about to be 5 years old. So I was plunged into a situation of dealing with suicide. I'm sure there are many suicide survivors among us here. But it's not an easy thing to deal with. But I also was faced with the responsibility of parenting our child alone, and inevitably that involves you in many mundane things, getting her ready for school and all of this kind of thing, making sure she's fed and so on. But then on the other side of that, the need for positivity, if you like, the need for responsible behavior is the imagery that is drawn out by the impact of a suicide. And I found that both writing and music making were extremely cathartic in that sense. So that piece really is dealing with some of my, I suppose, darker feelings, these feelings that it's actually impossible to share with anybody else, because if you talk about this stuff openly, people are very shocked, they don't, in a way, people are encouraging you into, Steve said this earlier, they're encouraging you into a sense of normality, but this whole process takes a lot of time, and it will draw you into areas which are unpalatable, I suppose. And music is a gift in that sense, that you can reconcile yourself and to some degree other people by dealing with them through music. So in a way, it's hard for me to say exactly what that piece is about, but it's definitely about this passage through grief after dealing with a death like that.
I was really struck in your account of that period of your life, of some of the ways, things you had to do with your daughter, like she had a birthday party, like right away after that.
Yeah, she had a birthday party. I was organizing a funeral and a birthday party at the same time. And, you know, that pulls you in exactly this polarity that I'm talking about. And I think, you know, things like writing and music, they can help you process all of that. So it's not that the process of grieving becomes the point of the music, but these profound and often very unfamiliar and disturbing emotions and psychological states can kind of work themselves out through the music. And I think other people who've gone through that experience, they can recognize that. I mean, it's, you know, this question of sound and loss. I ended up developing a whole theory about sound as the embodiment of loss. Now, I agree with what Ishmael says. You know that when you're working with sound, when you're making music, you're always making something, and that is extremely positive. So this idea of loss as being a negative thing is an example, I think, of our fearfulness about death, because death is a reality, loss is a reality. Yeah, it's something we all experience. And nostalgia is a good example. If you look on YouTube, so many clips you look at, people are saying, oh, why don't they make music like this anymore? You know, when I was young, this was great music, nothing compares to it. Then, you know, every genre of music, that kind of nostalgia is one of the ways in which people engage with music. You know, that it touches them. You know, it's meaningful. So, you know, that sense of loss, I think, is just a reality of life, and music helps us deal with it.
I'm thinking of Steve, you and Kelly, knowing the potential of loss from the beginning of your relationship must have given you that profound insight into this reality of loss as a part of every day. And Efrim, you have you made a group that in some ways existed as a form of expressing loss and memorializing, the Mount Zion group, which really has explored this area in many different ways. I wonder if you could talk a little bit about that.
Sure, yeah. I mean, the band's, I mean, speaking of the aftermath of what was just spoken of, this is going to sound very small, but the band was formed after my dog died, which seems like a very small thing, but I
Laurie Anderson also made a work about that, actually.
Okay.
You're in good company.
But for me, like I had led this very isolated childhood, and then left home very early, and was, you know, sort of running in the streets with other kids. So I had no attachments, and I had this dog Wanda, and when she died, that was my formative grief experience, which is strange and a little pathetic, but it's true. You know, like it was my first experience in that way.
Common, also, though, I think. Especially for young people.
Yeah, except I was in my late 20s at that point. You know what I mean? Like, it speaks more to what my life had been up to that point, you know?
Common among musicians, maybe, or indie musicians anyway.
Yeah, maybe.
Or some I've known.
And up until that point, like, my entire experience in music had been, you know, music as a social activity that was sort of recorded and documented, kind of like writing things down in a notebook and throwing them into a random puddle and hoping that someone found them, you know? So in the aftermath of Wanda dying, who, in my defense, she was a beautiful and rare creature, it seemed to make sense to have this social activity in the aftermath. And again, just writing things down in a notebook, throwing them in a puddle, abandoning them and moving on, you know? And so, yeah, then the thesis of the band became to keep sort of memorializing big and small death, you know, and sort of marking the passage of time and continuing to write things down in notebooks and throwing and abandoning them to puddles.
How did you decide what else? Because there are songs grieving friends, there are songs grieving sort of larger strangers, I guess, you know, in the group.
Yeah, I don't know. I mean, it's, you know, it was what made sense in the moment, you know? I mean, there's plenty of grief in this world, you know? And we all experience it constantly, you know? And I do agree, it has to be, in some ways, it has to be normalized, you know? It has to be honored, but I think the best way to honor it is to normalize it, you know? We're all, I mean, there's a whole spectrum of emotions there. But we all have a hard time when someone we know is experiencing grief and we can't share it with them. We can't carry the grief with them, you know? Mm-hmm. And I don't know, it needs to be normalized, you know? We need to find the common words and we need to find new words. Because the fact is, given the historical moment, there are gonna be many more deaths, you know? We need to find new words.
I know that your music is influenced by Jewish traditions, and I wondered if you looked to, if there's a, you know, all religions express grieving in their core, at their core. And as I said before, there are some who think that religion would not exist if not for grieving, that is actually the historical, prehistorical source of the religious impulse. But I'm wondering, especially in the Jewish tradition of Kaddish, and you know, how that factors in to your music making.
I don't believe in God, so let's start with that.
Many but, Jewish people don't.
Right, exactly. but yeah, I don't know. I mean, there's something, the Jewish idea of God is this sort of, I mean, God is this drama queen, you know? It's this irrational creature who casts apocalypse upon the earth randomly and, you know, holds long grudges, you know? I had this weird thing last year. I went out. There's a very strange bar. There's a Greek bar on my corner. That's it's like an illegal gambling joint. And I couldn't sleep one night, and I went to my front porch to have a cigarette. And I walked to my front porch, and there was a man lying in the street crying, and in the way of traffic. So I ran up to him, and I said, "Are you okay, brother?" And he had lost a bunch of money in this bar joint. And then immediately this other guy started making drama, all the bookies fled from the Greek joint, the police showed up, and then this old Greek man, I was standing there just confused, smoking my cigarette, and this old Greek man started speaking to me Greek, and I was like, "I'm sorry, I'm not Greek," and he looked at me and he said, "Jewish?" And I did a thing that Jews will understand, and be like, "Oh shit," you know, like, like what form of weirdness is coming? And then all he wanted to speak to me about was the Old Testament, and then we got in this hour-long debate about the book of Job, right? And it was basically a debate because the Christian ideal of God, the moral that he came from the book of Job was that you need to have faith, right? And I was trying to tell him, like, fuck that, brother, you know? The moral of the book of Job is you're gonna have faith, and God at some point is going to take some random fucking bets, you know? Fuck up your life, you know? Just to prove a fucking point, you know? And we got into this thing, and it lasted, and it was an okay debate. But anyways, yeah, I think that's all I have to say about Judaism is, you know, I do believe in the idea, you know, if you're going to make a God, I mean, fuck God, you know, but if you're going to make a God, it should at least represent the fact that the world is random and brutal and violent and people fucking die, and it's a fucking nightmare, you know, so you might as well, like, God should live in that world, you know, of just random and brutal and petty. You know?
And is music a bridge to that? Is music a bridge to that?
What's that?
Is music a bridge to that world, or is it a way of coping with that world, or both, or a channel? I don't know. I think about, like, the angels in Angels in America, you know, one of the great works about plague and grieving and how violent they are and how kind of horrible the angel is.
you know? And I think that's a great reclamation of a certain reality through art.
I mean, I mean, it's a subjective reality I'm speaking to, not an objective reality, but I think, like, if you don't, I always feel like a good place to start is things are shit, you know? And any joy needs to come from that thesis, you know? Like, you can't deny it, you know? Otherwise, what the fuck are you going to experience in this world, you know? If you just, yeah. Anyways,
but that's a subjective reality. From the mud grows the lotus. But from the mud grows the lotus.
Though. I'm not familiar with that phrase.
Ishmael. actually, what Efrem is talking about actually miraculously goes well into my next question, which is for you. You know, when I listen to Shabazz Palaces, I hear so much. One thing I hear is a strain, an undertone of, I don't know if I would call it sorrow, I would call it haunting, or there is a sense, and especially on these two most recent records, there's an overtone of questioning and challenging our values in the contemporary 21st century world, of a certain alienation from the status quo, and within that, not a grief, but a challenge. Some theorists might call this Afro-pessimism, and there is a strain in music and in theory about that. The idea of, well, I don't know, maybe Daphne can talk about it. Yeah, one moment. But as you confront the dystopian aspects of our culture, how does your music incorporate responses to loss and death, whether they're individual deaths or more cultural death and decay?
My most profound grief sense of it, experience with it, is my mother, Barbara. She passed away. And me and her were tight, and we were good friends. I learned everything that I've knew in my formative years from not just what she told me, but what I saw her doing. When she passed away, I remember people, you know, telling me they were sorry for my loss, but I was sorry for her loss because she was good at living. So I didn't really think of it as me losing, because she had lost life, you know, and she was good at it. So my grief was attached to her and what she lost. And then it was sad for me, obviously, and I had a very long period of grief, and it was dark for me. I made music during that time, which became the music of Shabazz Palaces. But what I figured out was she made me. You know, I was made out of her essence. So I was essentially living her life, continuing her life, you know? So I am sorry. I'm full of sorrow about that. It doesn't dissipate over the years. It rises up, swells all the time. But knowing that she was good at life, and I could sort of, when she passed, a new relationship between she and I was born, in which all of the experiences that I had with her, and grief deals a lot with memory and the active memory of things. And so I remember her all the time, and I feel like I'm living her life, you know, in another realm, another incarnation of it. So we still roll together, you know?
That's why that's not Afro-pessimism.
Yeah, I was gonna say, I'm definitely not an Afro-pessimist. at all.
Well, can you tell? I want to play a cut from one of the Quasar's records, but tell for the audience, tell a little bit about the world building that happens on those records, the worlds you build on those records.
Well, I'm 50, so I wasn't around with the personal device, you know, and the application of it and the proliferation of it. So I've always approached it very warily, you know, and my participation with it and my observation of it is kind of with squinted eyes, you know? So the world that Quasars is coming from is kind of that world, you know, where I accept everything. I'm not the type of person that wants to go back to the old days and I want the youth to pull their pants up and all that kind of stuff. I'm with the shit. I like all the new stuff, but I remember the essence of where I came from, and so it's weird to me. These times are weird as hell, you know? So that's where Quasars is coming from.
Let's hear Welcome to Quasars.
Behold the soft cyber caress, my television. Driving a mape shit, recorded with tape hiss, a glitch in a matrix. Pay attention. Right on. Thank you.
So that song contains the provocative line, "We killed death." And I just, it's not exactly a victory cry. I just want you to talk a little bit about how the idea of vanquishing death fits into this vision of Quasars.
Well, I feel like I be tripping off selfies, you know, like the duplication of your image, and then you put it out in the world, and then it gets duplicated more and more. People can share it or send it somewhere else, and it's just like, it seems like you're departing from yourself and just letting yourself loose out into a wilderness, you know? And I feel like it's our attempt at immortalizing ourselves, and it's like kind of like feeble, futile, and so self-centered that it's kind of a death, or at least a acquiesce to it. From the moment you do it, you're like, here, just take me. I don't care what happens to me from this point on. So that's kind of what that was about.
I love that, and makes me think of that old anthropological cliche that, you know, certain people in certain cultures are afraid to have their pictures taken because their souls will be stolen. But it also makes me think, want to return to David's insight into sound and how sound always feels like loss, and we forget sound so much more easily, in a sense, that we forget images, I think. I was saying to Steve earlier that when I think about how my daughter spoke when she was 5 and she had a lisp, I remember Bob Criscow loved that lisp of my daughter's lisp, and honestly, I can't remember it. Like, I can't remember what it sounded like, and that breaks my heart. You know, that's a death in a way. It's a loss. You know, and so that's, I get back to the thing of like, does music always contain loss? Because it always contains the potential of fading.
Can I just say something? This is the wonkish performance studies scholar in me for a second here. So there's this old school debate that went down at NYU back in the 90s between Peggy Phelan, who wrote about performances always vanishing. The moment of performance is the ephemeral moment of always vanishing, right? And into that world of meditation on that subject came the mighty Fred Moden, who said, you know, actually, we can think about resonances and reverberations in our being that really push back against this idea of ephemerality, and that's very important to marginalize people, to say, this stuff doesn't disappear, it lives on, which actually, you know, Ishmael gave us this very gorgeous meditation on that idea. So I guess I want to be careful with how we think about ephemerality and vanishing and the ways that we hold on to, care for, reimagine, regenerate this stuff that lives on in different forms.
Well, absolutely. There are always echoes and vibrations. And maybe sound isn't lost. Maybe it's recycled. I just want to know what you have to say about this.
Yeah, I think it's a really interesting point. And there's something else to think we should talk about here, which is the loss of musics. Now, we have an idea that music changes all the time because music business is business. It's you know, it's one of the most driven businesses for innovation and change. So we're used to that. It's part of capitalism. But there are other musics which have been subject to a great extinction in the 20th and 21st century. Many traditional musics around the world have completely disappeared for reasons, multiple reasons. Wars, missionary work, religious conversions of one kind or another, modernity, migration, so on and so on and so on. But one way or another, many of these musics have disappeared. And the extraordinary thing is, hardly anybody cares, you know? I mean, people care about pandas disappearing, but they don't care about music disappearing. So that to me is a kind of tragedy. And I think, you know, this memory that you're talking about, I mean, in a way, it's a fragile thing. But then in another way, it's incredibly strong. And I think we have a kind of responsibility maybe to remember these musics because, I mean, what is music anyway? It's an articulation of the way people live together, whether they live together badly or live together well. But it's about that as much as it's about anything else. So all of these different forms that have disappeared, many of them totally unique, they represent different experiments, you know, in this project of ours to somehow get by on this planet. And so, yeah, I think that's important to remember in this discussion.
How does preservation factor in? Or, you know, when I think about recordings of musics from around the world, is that a valuable ghost? Are they valuable ghosts?
Well, yeah. I mean, I recorded Yanomami Shamanism in 1978. And those recordings were fairly recently released in a more or less complete form. And I don't think there are any other examples you can hear of that way of life, that approach to cosmology and to social life and the natural world and so on. So in some sense, yes, of course it's important, but in another sense it is also a ghost. I mean, these things are cultural memories, yes, for sure.
That makes me want to turn and ask a question I have for you about Jeff Buckley. And because I'm thinking about recordings as ghosts, as present ghosts in our lives, I digress for a moment and say, Steve, for you, you live with your own ghosts. You have huge hits. I encountered your ghost at Mitchell Deli while I was eating a sandwich.
I just saw my ghost up here 5 minutes ago.
And your ghost can rock white pants like nobody. But I mean, it's a strange fact of and I mean, sampling is a form of living with ghosts in a sense, and not necessarily in a negative sense, you know. But when you're writing about a voice that is not occupying a human body anymore, as you did when you wrote about Jeff Buckley, it's complicated. You know, you're forging a connection both with what their art expresses, but also with what you feel about the cessation of that voice. And I'm just going to read a couple, since we got to hear music from, we're hearing music from everybody, a passage from your book. It's short. Daphne wrote, I have been protecting myself from going all the way back in, from immersing myself again in that extraordinarily heartbreaking period, the period when you found out that Jeff Buckley had died, and from embracing the fact that writing about Jeff Buckley's music is and will forever be a difficult and painful ride, an endless seesaw between euphoria and utter grief, ecstasy and excruciating despair. Like the very act of listening to Jeff Buckley, writing about him was and has always been a matter of life and death, and a struggle to honor a passionate soul whose wretchedly untimely passing somehow irrevocably altered my life.
So can you talk about writing that book in grief?
Wow, you didn't tell me you were going to ask me that. yes, I can. I can say that was the hardest thing that I ever did. I didn't want to do it. I mentioned that. And David Barker, who started the 33 and one-third series, had said, I said, oh, let me write about Radiohead, OK Computer, or Lauryn Hill, please let me. And he said, you don't want to write about Jeff Buckley, so I actually think you need to do that. And so, you know, in the ways that we've been discussing tonight, it was about having to confront, you know, all of the reasons why his loss encapsulated many things for me. And it did mean getting very close to not just the way the music had made me feel when he was alive, but also a kind of, I had to wrestle with how mortality, now we're getting all personal, had just hung in my life from the moment that I was conscious of my parents being older parents. So I had kind of like this heaviness around my household. They were very well until my dad became, you know, sick in 1997. But, and I had older siblings. So I'd grown up with this kind of weird, you know, out of step consciousness of passages and mortality. And so his passing, which also coincided 97 with my dad becoming sick, became kind of just a larger kind of confrontation with the universe and, of course, my own mortality, right? Which is what we always have to think about. So I was trying to really to honor all of that when I was writing through it, and to also to get back to simultaneously the euphoria that his music tapped into at the same time. And he used to talk about that too, that those songs, people wrote about this so often, but those songs were so weirdly foreshadowing, right, of one's passage. So he was constantly kind of wrestling with those polarities.
Do you feel that someone who hears Jeff Buckley now, what is the experience of discovering a voice whose body is gone?
Oh, God.
I mean, honestly, I'll open that to the group because I think that's a that's something that's happens for all of us. I mean, we just commemorated the 25th anniversary of Kurt Cobain's death. Right. Many teenagers today fall in love with Kurt. His voice, his being, his picture that they can buy on a T-shirt at Target.
I felt sad when Scott Walker died very recently. I met him in 2012, and I'd always loved his music. And his music was just went further and further out and confronted issues of death and degradation and violence and oppression and, you know, I mean, I think his career was extraordinary. But when I met him, I said to him, what do you feel about this age thing? you know, how does it affect you? And he said, well, you know, things go. The voice will go. But, you know, hopefully you're thinking is there. And I said, how do you feel about that? And he said, yeah, I'm okay with that. And I think, well, when I met him, he was probably 70, 69. And he, when he died, he was 76. So I met him, what, 7 years ago. I'm 70 next month. So I'm like that character in White Noise by Don DeLillo, the guy who's always looking at the obituaries to see how long he's got. But yeah, if you have that personal connection with either an artist's work or them personally, then it has a tremendous impact.
You know, tonight I've heard the word haunting. I've heard certain words that sort of describe the idea of listening to music in a ghost kind of way. if you think about, I think about music and how it works is a very strange thing. Because really, we're just walking flesh, and somehow these tones and sounds that we talked about backstage resonate with us in a way that conjures ghost-like feelings and images. In fact, some of the recordings are little ghosts in time, as we've talked about, and they have a tendency, I think, to remain that to us personally, but they are invisible until they hit your inner ear, and then they go in your mind, and they recall spots where you first heard that song, what it means to you, what's going on today, what's not going on. They conjure all these emotions, and I'm sure, chemically, there's all this other brain chemistry that kicks in. So it's really a bit of a haunting, invisible experience, music. And I think all of it I've heard tonight is like getting in touch with that which really isn't here, you know? As you said, I've had the same experience. You lost your mother. When I lost my father, it was really profound, because I had had issues with my dad and justified resentments, let's just call them that, you know? And then it dawned on me. One day I was looking at the back of my hand and I pinched the skin on the back of my hand and I realized that every bit of that is made up from him and my mother. I am my father. I am made up of my father. I did not get here any other way. I don't know about you guys, but that's how we got here. And in that sense, you want to call that spirit? You want to call that continuance? You want to call it a blessing? Whatever feels good. For me, I call it reality. You know, I am made up of my dad. And lastly, I would like to just say that when he passed, and this I experienced this with Kelly also, that when he passed, there was an incredible, profound loss in front of me. Then all of a sudden, this other thing happened to where the grieving process was so intense because now they were in here more than they were out here. And that's where I felt them for the first time, was here, not out here anymore. So I must say for me, they were louder in here than they were out here when they were alive. It's so weird. But to be honest with you, because when we take it for granted, oh, Dad, yeah, I'll call you Tuesday. You know? But when they're gone, all of a sudden the place that they're there the loudest for me was in me, back of my hand. That becomes a haunting and a part of the spirit. And I think music resonates with all that. When you listen to a piece of music and you get goosebumps on your arm, how does that happen? Tell me why. It just does, you know?
I think we should listen to... We're running out of time. I have more tracks by everyone, but I just want that what you're saying makes me want to turn to a track that you recorded for Trace's. Can you play I Need You? Because music also can be a conduit. Other people's music can be a conduit for our own grief and our own hope.
You don't realize how much. Oh, yeah.
Yes, I'm saying turn down a Beatles song sung by Steve Perry. I'm horrible. I love that rendition, and there's many reasons, and I just, in relation to what you were just saying, though, I want to say, so many, we could say hauntings or traces run through that recording, obviously traces of the original, traces of your own, what you were saying about Scott, what Scott said about his voice. I'm hearing Steve's voice, which is still beautiful, but is an older voice,
yeah.
And so that is another, like the whole lineage of your voice is in that performance as well.
It's change, you know. It's change, and it's you. You well, I'm trying just to be where I'm at, who I am, where I'm at, who I am. You know, this is where I'm at, and this is who I am, and so I'm just trying to be as much of that I am right now that I can give. If that's what the voice is, then... And the other thing about the voice, then I'll give it. But the other thing about my voice now is it's been through a lot more. Mm-hmm. I mean, there's, life has had its way with me too, you know. You think, oh, Steve Perry, he got to be a singer, rock band. Man, we are no different. Life has had its way with me just like it has it with you. And we all grieve, we all laugh, we all cry. It's all the same, you know. So this is what it is.
Ishmael, you...
I owe you money right here.
Just the picture.
Do you have the... Ishmael, you've been rapping, a rapper for so many years too, and your voice still sounds amazing, but there's probably been changes too. Do you feel similar that I mean, the trace of your old voice and your new voice, or how do you relate to the changes in your voice?
I think it's kind of like with your daughter's list. It's like I was there the whole time, so I didn't really register it changing. I recognize it as myself. But I'm not singing like Brother Steve, so it's like, it's different, you know what I mean? But yeah, I feel it.
I really was planning on playing more tracks by everyone, but we're getting to the point in the evening where they're gonna throw us out, and I wanna make sure that the audience gets a chance to ask questions. So I'm going to ask people who'd like to ask questions to line up at the mic and, you know, I do want to play a tiny bit of one last song, and it's a song by Efrim, because I think this is a beautiful song that that really captures how a loss can, the experience of a loss can change in the moment of a gift or a new life, and I'm just gonna play a little bit of it, have him play it. It's a Where's my title? I'm losing that. I am no longer a motherless child. Can you play just a little bit of that song? Look at my boy. I love that song so much. That song reminds me of Ooh Child by the Five Stair Steps. It's just one of those songs that takes you into the space of, you know, beauty and hope. And thank you for that song. Tell the story behind it.
I don't know. My reaction right now, there's a very dear friend, when I recorded that song, I played it for her, and she's that guitar bullshit at the beginning. She was like, one rotation is enough. And I was like, no, fuck you, it has to be two. And sitting here right now, that was like sitting through 9 funerals in a row. So... So
about.
To my dear friend, I got to say she was right. One rotation was fucking plenty. Holy cow. Fuck. Yeah.
But there's only one lyric. There's like 2 lines in that song, but the song says so much. So.
Oh, yeah. I mean, shit. I mean, it's a basic thing. And anyone, I don't know, anyone who's had children, who's had, you know, maybe not the best relations with their parents, there is something redeeming about raising a child. When you've been, if you've been raised poorly, you know? And that's it, you know? It doesn't take many more words than that, you know? Yeah.
Circle of life. Yeah. Thank you for that song. All right, well, before we open to the floor, I just want to thank all of our panelists. We could have talked for 2 hours, and normally we would have talked for 2 hours, as you know, but Pop Conference has passed. But there's so much more to learn from these artists and writers here, and I hope you check out their work if you don't know it already, and thank you for listening. And thank you to everyone for sharing these beautiful stories you shared with us. All right.
First, thank all of you for bringing the topic to light. I'm a middle school educator, and it's difficult seeing children go through the loss and not having someone or someone to relate to. And optimally, they seek music as a refuge. So by all means, please go out and spread the word and let them know that it is okay to talk about it and it is okay to feel those feelings. I had a specific question for Steve. Are there 2 or 3 different coping mechanisms that helped you get through the loss of your of your parents and Kelly, because I've recently lost my mother and I'm struggling, as an understatement.
I'm sorry for your loss. And one of the things I decided to do was actually mentioned tonight, I think it might have been Dave, that when people sort of give you the opinion that you should be over it by now, or they give you a timeline they think is expired, like you should move on and all that kind of stuff, don't listen to that. Because everybody's individual experience, in my opinion, is going to be individually their own. And what that person meant to you and how much it has impacted you, the only person who can walk through it and get it through the other side of it is you, really. No one can walk through it for you. And my experience has been, once again, not to sound redundant, but if you cherish the grief, as painful as it is, and I mean, sometimes I also got into some dark places, as you had mentioned, by myself, you know, in the dark of the night, and you get a case of, what's it all about? What's the point? You know, what am I doing? I guess those places have to be gone into to come out of. At least that's been my experience. And I think it's a healthy thing to do. And just remember, you know, the back of your hand, pinch that skin, that is your mother.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm.
Thank you.
Thank you, everyone, for sharing tonight. It was really empowering to listen to people share grief. It's something my husband and I have recently experienced, the loss of our 19-year-old daughter, and it's something that people don't like to talk about, especially when children are involved. My question to the panel is, I used to be a really prolific writer before my daughter passed away, and now I've got a huge block. It used to come very naturally and easy for me, and now when I try to write, it's so raw and ugly and messy that I just stop. My question is, how do you find the courage to push through that? And then more specifically, the second part is for Steve. I know that you have mentioned you've walked away from music a long time ago, for many, many years, and you just kind of cut music out of your life. How did you reassimilate that creative outlet back into your life after so long, after you'd closed it off for so long? So that's my question to you and the panel.
David, you write in your book about working after.
Yeah, I think that ugliness that you're confronted with is very, very difficult because it seems to intensify the feeling. But again, I very much agree with Steve that everybody has their own feelings and they're very much your feelings, you know, so to some extent, this judgment of ugliness, a kind of inner violence, is how I experienced it, is personal to you. You know, maybe you're thinking in terms of the way other people perceive it, but that doesn't matter, you know? There's a lot of things going on in the processing of grief. And some of them are extremely ugly. And you know, you can think badly about yourself, the things you feel you did wrong. You can feel hostility towards the person who's died. And that feels ugly. But they're all part of the process. And I think you can just push that and push that. I had an experience where I not long after my wife had died, I was offered a solo gig playing in Switzerland, and it was a terrifying gig because you had to play for an hour solo for an audience and for live radio. So, you know, so that in itself is bad enough. And I was going through, I think, something similar to what you're talking about. I was writing things which were very honest and raw. And I read one of these passages during this performance, and afterwards the organizer said to me, he said, "Oh, a bit morbid." I thought, "Oh, thanks, you know, but his opinion was irrelevant, really. You know, it was what I had to do. And doing it took me through that to something, you know, that was less raw, less ugly, but that was just a stage. And I think just persevere and you'll feel that, you know, that eventually the writing will come back to you.
Thank you.
It's a complicated question, but it's a good one. I was pretty burnt out on music when I left, completely toasty. I mean, we had a great run. That was the 80s, and everything that came with the 80s burnt me out. Okay. And I just wanted to stop. And I knew that I had lost my passion, the original passion I had for singing was slowly going away. And sure, I could keep turning the wheel. We could still show up at the venues and I could sing the songs, but I wasn't connecting. And the less I connected, the more scared I got. So I said to myself, I need to stop. It was not received very well, not just by the fans. Certainly the band were not happy about it. But sometimes you gotta take care of yourself. You have to. And it's not gonna be a popular decision. Yeah. And I made an unpopular decision, and I'm glad I did now in retrospect, but it took all those years of going back into my hometown and riding my motorcycle by alfalfa fields and forgetting how cool it is in the summertime when you're right by an alfalfa field.
Yeah.
You know, I forgot. There was things, you know, ice cream at Superior Dairy. Wow, you know, I forgot because so many great things had happened and I was on this incredible ride. But when music came back, it wasn't really gonna come back because I was kind of pushing it away. The creative process is what you're talking about. And oddly enough, when I fell in love with Kelly, and as scary as it was to fall in love with somebody who potentially was sick, but I believed our love was gonna make this thing go away. And I was gonna give myself to her more than anybody in my whole life I ever done before. And I did. And then when I lost her, one of the promises she asked of me was that if something was ever to happen to her, that I would not go back into isolation. I made that promise so that when I did lose her, I had a promise to keep. That got me back into feeling my feelings about music. And I swear to you, as he just said, when I sat down with my laptop the first time, started sketching my first ideas, it was so frightening. Because there I was alone with everything. All my feelings, all the hopes, all the fears, all the darkness, things I just would rather just close the computer and go for a walk or something. But, you know, there's no other way to walk through it than to walk through it. And I'm so glad I did. There'd be good days, there'd be bad days. But now, I rediscovered my love for music. I rediscovered the people that I used to listen to when I was younger. You know, the Sam Cooke, the Marvin Gaye, the people that moved me when I was a kid, that made me go, how is he, what's he doing? How does he get in here like that? How does he do that when I hear him? You know, I rediscovered those feelings. And wanted to go get some of that again and touch that again, you know, and try to bring it back out to see if it comes out that maybe somebody out there might want to hear it again. So, isolate. You know, it's isolation is a really good tool, but it's not a good idea. Too much, you know.